This is a special report of South Dakota Public Television.
Good evening, I'm Todd David Epp, and we're simulcasting on South Dakota Public Television and Radio. We're preempting Garden Line this evening to talk about the situation with the governor's airplane. As many of you heard earlier this afternoon, Governor George S. Mickelson's twin-engine airplane crashed near Dubuque, Iowa. Television station KDUB in Dubuque and the Associated Press have reported that all eight passengers, including Governor Mickelson, are dead. The passenger list includes Governor George S. Mickelson, Roger Hange, Director of the Sioux Falls Development Foundation, Roland Dolly, State Economic Development Director, Ron Reed, State Energy Policy Commissioner, Dave Berklin, a Sioux Falls banker, Angus Anson of Northern States Power in Sioux Falls, and pilots Ron Becker and Dave Hansen from Pier. Apparently, the plane lost power near Dubuque while en route from a meeting in Cincinnati, Ohio. The pilots reported a loss of power and requested to make an emergency landing. Minutes later, the twin-engine Mitsubishi turboprop crashed into a barn in Silo, southwest of Dubuque. We've established a fiber optic hookup to Pier via the State Rural Development Telecommunications Network. In a little bit, we're going to hear from Janelle Toman, the governor's press secretary. And also in our Brookings studio, we have Colonel Dwight Adams, Governor Mickelson's former campaign director, also Republican State Senator Dick Negstead from Volga, and Al Lundy, a reporter from South Dakota Public Radio. And via telephone, we'll be hearing from Senate Majority Leader Democrat Roger McKellips from Alcester. And Janelle, are you there on the line with us, please?
Yes, I am.
Janelle, what can you tell us about the situation?
Well, Todd, there's very little new information from the authorities in Iowa. From what I issued earlier, we received a call from the Federal Aviation Administration shortly before 5 p.m. This afternoon notifying us that a South Dakota State plane had gone down near Dubuque, Iowa this afternoon. You have basically confirmed the details that we know, 8 fatalities at the site. My understanding is they're still attempting to confirm the identities of the fatalities. However, I also have news reports that indicate that Governor Mickelson is among those. We have been in contact with many people across the country, other governors, and there's been a real outpouring of support and concern. And I also would like to read a brief statement from Lieutenant Governor Walter Dale Miller, who issued this statement after hearing of the confirmation of Governor Mickelson's death. And I quote, "All of my thoughts are in prayer with the members of the families who are now suffering the loss of their loved ones. There are no words to describe the sadness that I and the people of South Dakota feel tonight." We have very little additional information, as I said. We are advised that the Federal Aviation Administration is en route conducting a full investigation into the situation.
Janelle, I just wanted to add our condolences from everyone here at South Dakota Public Broadcasting to you and to the staff, the governor's staff, and to all the families. It's a terrible, shocking thing that's happened, and we're very saddened here in Brookings and Vermilion too. Janelle, where do we go from here? What are the next steps? What are you trying to put together there and peer with the Lieutenant Governor and the rest of the cabinet?
Well, as you may be aware, Todd, provisions in state law provide for a very orderly administration of the executive branch. Anytime governor is out of the state, Walter Dale does act as the acting governor in his absence. So of course, today, while the governor was out of state, Walter Dale Miller was acting in that capacity and will continue to act in that capacity. There are very basic provisions set down in the Constitution for an orderly transfer of power, and that will be undertaken as soon as is practical.
Okay. Any kind of arrangements yet for the people involved? I know it's pretty early yet, Janelle.
I have received no information regarding any arrangements. I'm sure those will be being made in the next day.
Okay. Anything else you can tell us, Janelle, before we let you go?
I think that's about it.
Okay. Thank you very much, Janelle. Again, my condolences to you and to the staff in Pier as well and to the families involved as well. Here in our Brookings studio, we have three gentlemen who have a great deal of familiarity with the governor and the administration, and on the phone too, Roger McKellips. Let me start with you, Colonel Adams, Dwight Adams. You were the governor's campaign manager. You've known him a long time. We had the unfortunate duty of informing you of what happened. What are you feeling right now, Dwight?
Pain. It was, give me a minute. It was a shock. I had not heard the news. I was attending a meeting at my church when I had the phone call, and it's a tremendous shock, as it is to everybody across the state. My heart goes out to Linda, the children, sisters, all of the family. It's just unbelievable.
You worked very, very closely with Governor Mickelson through the years, political campaigns and so forth. What kind of man was George Mickelson?
George was one of the most dynamic leaders and one of the finest men I've ever known. And I have been involved, having spent 35 years in the military, with a lot of people in key leadership positions. George ranked up there with the top of all of them. He was a man who was dedicated to the interests of South Dakota. I remember very well, and I thought of it as we were sitting here waiting. After his election in the first campaign, he turned to me one day and he said, Dwight, he said, I can't wait to get started. I'm looking forward so much to doing this job for the people of South Dakota. That typified his approach to the job. He was a man who was organized, he set goals, he made plans, and he carried them out. Nobody would outwork him during campaigns, during his tenure as governor, as the leader of the people of this state, and now, of course, working in the interests of the nation in terms of particularly the health care issues that is at the forefront in the present national administration. He was a tremendous man and leader.
Let me turn to my colleague Al Lundy from South Dakota Public Radio. Al, you've been covering politics for about as long as anybody I know around here, Republicans, Democrats. I guess, what are you feeling right now?
Well, it's tough. I don't know whether we've had a governor die in office. At least this way. And it's interesting to me, and either ironic or fitting, whichever word you might use, to note that he died while on an economic development trip.
That's one of the keystones, particularly in the beginning of his administration, was economic development, and the John Morrell's issue has been something ongoing.
That was the thing that he was most concerned with when he ran the first time for governor, and was at the forefront of everything that he wanted to do. Was he recognized the need for diversifying the economic level and situation in the state of South Dakota with the changing in the agricultural community. And that was at the forefront, and he's worked extremely hard at that. And you're right, Al, it was almost a touch of irony that tied in with one of the major industries of our state, that's what he was doing today and working on that program.
Let me turn to Dick Negstead. Dick, state senator from here in Brookings County, from Volga, and Dick served on the county commission for a number of years before that. I don't know. Dick, you got to see Governor Mickelson before he was Governor Mickelson as well, when he was working for the city, I believe, the utilities attorney, and among other things, and the state's attorney. Any recollections you want to share?
Well, I knew him for quite a while, and of course, it was great. I have a lot of sympathy for the family, all the families involved. This is a great tragedy for them, of course, and for the whole state. I did know Governor Mickelson long before he was governor in a variety of different ways. Fact is, he was my own attorney. And I always had high respect for him. He was a fine individual. He was an excellent governor. And as was pointed out, it is interesting or ironic that he should pass away when he was working on economic development. He's done a lot for our state in economic development. He felt strongly about it. And a lot of new industries, new jobs in our state. So it really is a sad day.
Maybe talk a little bit about his work with the legislature and maybe how it changed through the years and his style of leadership with you 105 people.
Well, I felt he had a good style of leadership. It was a case where if you didn't agree with him, you could go discuss it. You might sometimes have a heated discussion in the process, but he was not the type that would put someone down. You could have the debate and still be friends afterwards. I thought he had a good style of leadership. He was, as Dwight pointed out, an excellent leader. He was a strong leader, but that's what you need as a governor. He was an excellent governor, and I felt that occasionally the legislature wasn't cooperative enough in going, getting along with him.
Okay, let's see if we can go to the telephone. Roger McKelps, the majority leader from the Senate. Okay, we don't have Roger yet on the phone. We're trying to get him. Dr. Bob Burns, who is with the Political Science Department here at South Dakota State University, is just literally sat down on our set. And Bob, I'm sure you're as shocked as we are to hear the news. Governor Mickelson, you know, he was a townsperson of ours here in Brookings. Janelle talked a little bit while you were coming in about the transition of power. What's the constitutional process here? What's going to happen next?
Well, as we speak, Walter Dale Miller is the new governor, and he has power to appoint a new lieutenant governor subject to approval of both chambers of the South Dakota legislature. It may well be that there will be a special session before the regular January session. I would think that probably would happen, but that's probably the least of people's concerns right now.
Have we ever had a governor die in office in South Dakota?
Not to my knowledge. Mm-hmm. We're reminded of several years ago when the governor and lieutenant governor and nearly the whole succession to office from the state of Utah went down in a plane crash. And it set a kind of precedent for having the governor and lieutenant governor not travel together ordinarily in air travel. And
okay. I guess one of the things that struck me about the governor was, I think some has been expressed here, he and I would go round and round sometimes in news conferences, but he always treated me with respect. He always treated me fairly. He usually gave me good answers, honest answers to all the questions I asked him, and I always thought that was the mark of a good leader, someone who could look you in the eye and say what he was going to do and then try to do it, and respect respect the press and the people in the press as well. And I know it can be a contentious thing sometimes, but I always respected the governor for that very, very much, that he had a regard for what Al and I and others had to do as well. And I know it wasn't always very easy for him when we were sometimes not as informed on things and asking him questions about things.
I agree with that, and to me that's the same analysis with the legislature and the governor. You could have a strong debate about a subject and he would treat me with respect, and you could go back and discuss something else the next day and that would be forgotten. So I think that was an excellent quality he had.
Mm-hmm. And he had a good sense of humor too.
Yeah, he did.
I remember one time we were flying back from a online program, and he broke out into one of his fraternity songs about being a big guy, and it struck me as kind of out of character, but it was one of the funniest things I've ever seen a politician do, and I'm glad I have that memory of Governor Mickelson as well, as this big hearty laugh and a jovial song and a sense of humor about himself as well.
I think Dwight can probably speak to this better than any of us, though,
how very much he wanted to be governor, and how he wanted to be a public servant, giving up his law practice a year in advance to seek the Republican nomination. Dwight was very close to him back then, and Dwight can probably comment on his commitment to public service and how much it did mean to him.
I'd mentioned, Bob, just before you came in, one of the things that I'd sort of forgotten and tucked away that, and I thought of it sitting here tonight, that he said to me after the election was over the first time in 1986, and I'm repeating this here, but it is indicative of the man and the point you're making. He turned to me one day and he said, Dwight, he said, I can't wait to get started. I'm so anxious to get going and to get to work, to do the things I think we need to do for the people of South Dakota. He truly was dedicated to that. I recall another time during that campaign, I've already commented that nobody was going to outwork George, absolutely nobody. And we had him out going door to door around this state, and that wasn't a PR thing, that was just a lot of statistics or figures. George was out there winter, summer, whatever, going door to door around this state. And he came in, and after putting in a tremendously arduous week and one day, and as we all do sometimes when we're tired, he was a little bit distressed and unhappy and about things. And I looked up to him and I said, George, how much do you want to really be governor now? And that's all it took, just to remind him what he was setting out to do. He was truly dedicated to serving the people of South Dakota. But you know, there's more to be said about George, too. Aside from being a great leader and having done a great job as governor and providing the leadership to the state, he was a tremendous person, a man. I've known him since he arrived here in Brookings, so in the mid to late 60s when he came here and opened law practice. He had just hadn't been returned too long from Vietnam. I worked on a number of events and community affairs with him and got to know him somewhat, even with an age differential between us, and we were not close in the sense of being social peers, but very impressed with the man, the quality, the high moral character. He was a tremendous family man. His family was very, very important to him, every member of that family. So in any way you want to analyze him, he truly was an outstanding man.
We are taking questions. If you, we're not sure we can answer a lot of things, but if you have some questions, we do have phone volunteers standing by, 1-800-568-6922, and those will get passed on to me, and I will ask our panel as well. Roger McKellips in Alcester. Roger, are you with us? Good evening, Senator. I hope you've heard quite a bit of what we've been talking about. What's your reaction, what's your feelings upon hearing of death of the governor and the folks in his party?
I just got a sick feeling in my pit of my stomach when I heard the news. You know, it's a tremendous loss for the people of South Dakota, Democrats and Republicans alike. You just can't express what you feel. And of course, our condolences go out to Linda and the boys and their daughter. Just something that's kind of hard to handle. During this last legislative session, I just developed a tremendous amount of respect for the governor, the way he treated us. You know, we didn't always agree, but we had really good discussions. He treated us with respect, never went behind our back. And, I just don't know what a session is going to be like now, 7 years with the governor, and now we aren't going to have him. And, you know, you just feel a terrible loss.
How does this change the relationship between the parties, between the Democrats and Republicans? Does it strengthen the bonds or the relationships?
I don't think it can help but strengthen us. You know, we're all going to rally around. When we're in trouble, we all bind together. You know, I called the governor's office and talked to Frank Brost and offered anything we could do to help. If it would help for the leadership to come to Pierre in the next few days, we certainly would do to show support to Walter Dale and his challenge ahead. But I think it's going to bring us together. You know, there's so many things left undone that he'd planned, just the morale package alone, and now who's going to pick up the pieces there? We're all going to have to put our shoulder to the wheel and forget political differences and show complete support.
Dr. Burns, a little bit ago, Senator McKellips thought maybe a special session or something if we need to, if Walter Dale Miller decides to appoint a lieutenant governor. What do you see the process as right now? Senator, are you still there? I'm sorry, did you hear my question?
I was unclear on the process. The governor, the sitting governor, can appoint a lieutenant governor subject to approval of the House and Senate, and I think it might be appropriate for us to do that. We certainly would come in, I think, without pay if that's, you know, I think that would be appropriate also. It would be just a matter of form. I'm sure anybody that Walter Dale would appoint, we'd certainly approve.
Okay. Again, we are taking questions from you, our viewers and listeners, 1-800-568-6922. Dr. Burns.
Certainly one of the tragic ironies of today is that the governor was killed along with other loyal state employees and city employees or city development corporation individuals. The governor was pursuing his dream of economic development in South Dakota. And I think really if there's a major issue area that Governor Mickelson will be remembered for, it would be his dedication to economic development. And as I said, that's the terrible irony of today's events. And
We're getting calls from listeners and viewers wondering what exactly has happened this evening. And unfortunately, we are here with some very bad news. Governor Mickelson and a party of seven others were in a plane crash near Dubuque, Iowa. The plane went down this afternoon. We've just in the last few minutes gotten confirmation that all aboard were dead. I can read the passenger list one more time and maybe we can get that up on screen. Besides Governor George Mickelson, Roger Hangey, Director of the Sioux Falls Development Foundation, Roland Dolly, the State Economic Development Director, Ron Reed, the State Energy Policy Commissioner, Dave Berklin, Sioux Falls banker, Angus Anson of Northern States Power in Sioux Falls, and pilots Ron Becker and Dave Hansen from Pier. Also, we are hoping to get some footage of the crash site and some other information from KDUB, the ABC affiliate in Dubuque. We're waiting for a satellite feed from that, and if we are still on at the time, we will show that to you as well. Frankly, we're kind of making this up as we're going this evening, and we hope you will stick with us. Again, we are taking questions. We're not sure we can answer everything, but one of the reasons that we're here this evening is to bring the state together, to mourn the loss of our governor and the people that were on the delegation as well, and to express our sympathy to the families and to the friends of the participants that were on this trip, and to, I guess, show everyone that we here in South Dakota care about what happens to each other. So with that, we are taking your calls. And I don't know, it's, Al, do you have anything comparable? I mean, you and I spend many a long road trip talking about things in our lives and covering politics. Is there anything that strikes you similarly about this to something else we've experienced?
It's, you know, it's hard to compare it to a lot of things. I think, it's certainly in some ways not the same scale as a president. Losing a president, international implications are involved in that situation, but certainly for the people of South Dakota and for the things that the governor worked on, economic development and all of the other things, and all of those other people that were with him. It was a shock this afternoon to hear about it, and it's one of those things that we have to I was talking to Janelle this afternoon when we were trying to get some information, and of course one of the things that she said when I was asking her, well, what happens now and so on, who's in charge and all that sort of thing, because for a while, of course, those of us trying to find out what was going on and those of us listening to the media and watching things didn't know if perhaps some odd chance the lieutenant governor might be on the plane, and we didn't know exactly who was with him. They didn't release that information at first, and so I was trying to find some things out, and she says one of the things about South Dakota government, and it's true most places in the country certainly, that as far as the government goes, it'll go on. It's just a tough thing to experience the loss in this way. You know, people die, you expect it. Governor Knipe, much after he was governor, died of an illness. Those things happen, and it was certainly not easy to take for those of us who knew him either, but Governor Mickelson was 51 years old, a young man.
I hope this is appropriate. This is I'm going to read a little bit of a poem by A.E. Houseman. British author, to an athlete dying young. I'm only going to read a couple of stanzas. The time you won your town the race, we cheered you through the marketplace. Man and boy stood cheering by, and home we brought you shoulder high. Today the road all runners come, shoulder high we bring you home, and set you at your threshold down, townsman of a stiller town. So, Roger McAllops, are you still on the phone?
I'm here, yeah.
Okay. Roger, what do we do to go on? I mean, Al's got a good point. You know, the government's going to continue and so forth. Is there any lesson in this tragedy for the rest of us?
You just wonder what, you feel so helpless in a situation like this. You know, I was visiting with Raleigh Dolly a couple of weeks ago, and we talked about the morale thing, and he says, you can't imagine the work that the governor and I have put in and the innovative plan and program we've got to save the morale plant. And he said, it's going to be something really new and different as far as innovative financing is concerned. And I suspect they finalized that thing today, and now you wonder who's going to carry forward with that plan. I suppose somebody will pick up the pieces, but you feel so helpless at this point in time. But we will. Nobody is indispensable and irreplaceable, I guess. You think so at the time, but we will pick up the pieces and we will move forward. But it's going to be a break in the action. There's no question about that. I can attest to the love that even reporters had. I've had three different reporters call me, and before they got done with their questioning, they all three broke down and couldn't continue. So you just sense the respect they had for that man.
Colonel Adams, you were in the military a long time, probably lost many friends to war. How do you go about rebuilding an organization? A huge loss for the state of South Dakota and the people of Sioux Falls. And how do you go about getting the things back on track and getting people there so we can go on?
Well, I think Senator McAllops made a very important point there a few minutes ago in a response to a question you asked him in that regard. And it's imperative at this time now that the people of South Dakota pull together, that both parties pull together, that the leadership of the House and the Senate on both sides all work together. Because this morale thing that's at the forefront of attention right now, because that was the issue today. But there are two other major issues also that we really haven't talked about here that the governor was extremely concerned about when he went into office, and as time went on in the office, that is going to require the support and work of people in both parties and the people of the state. And the one we touched on it briefly earlier is the health care issues. Our governor was already recognized as a national leader in that issue with the National Governor's Conference, not just the Republicans, but the National Governor's Conference. And he was a principal advisor with respect to the reform of health care. And he had great concerns that we come up with programs to provide health care for all of the people. And then another area that was very important that hasn't been mentioned to the governor when he went into office for his first term, and progress has been made, but there's room for a lot more progress yet, and that's in the field of education. Financing education, state being able to do more and finding some ways to do it, improving teachers' pay and all of these things. These are the tasks ahead. Now, how do you do it was your question. It's the rallying together of everybody concerned and the leadership that steps forward now and works under the lieutenant governor, will be the governor, or perhaps legally is the governor, I'm not sure how clear, just at what moment, I suppose, de facto he is the governor now, Bob. Legally probably hasn't been sworn in yet. That may have occurred. I don't know just how quick they do these things.
I haven't heard that official. I just assumed that he had been.
De facto, he is the governor, and people are going to have to work and support with him. And Senator McAllops, as the leader of the Democrat Party, is absolutely right when he said, we the people will support and will rally around, and that's how we'll get through this.
Just wanted to make sure I expressed the South Dakota Public Broadcasting Network's condolences to the family of Governor Mickelson and all the people who were involved in this crash. Our hearts go out to you, and you know, if there's anything we can do for any of you, please let us know, and I mean that, and we'll put our resources to work for what we can do for you as well. Again, I want to make that very strongly to all the people involved in this and your families and friends. We're very saddened, and I just want to express that very, very strongly. We're hoping... go ahead, Bob.
Add to Dwight's comments on Governor Mickelson's initiatives. I believed all along that Governor Mickelson was convinced that government could do good. And I think economic development was probably a foundation program. He had hoped that South Dakota could experience economic growth and generate more wealth within this state, which in turn could support some of these governmental initiatives. And whether it was in the area of education, or whether it was in the area of health care, or whether it was in the area of water development, I think that really was his vision, and certainly some evidence that the economic development that he had worked for was starting to occur within our state. Again, long way to go on so many of these things, but he did have a vision, and he was truly committed to it, and in a very unselfish sort of way. I don't think anyone that knew Governor Mickelson ever felt that that he was selfish in his service at all, but that he was doing it for this state that he had been raised in and that he had come to love so much, and for the people of this state.
It just occurred to me, I'd like to share with you and with the audience part of a vision that someone else had with respect to Governor Mickelson. A man of far-reaching visions who made a major contribution in many ways to this state, who is no longer with us. But he made it a point near the end of his appointed time on this earth to get together with me to talk one day at a luncheon. And there's only three or four people in the state know about this, that I've shared it with the governor, and I'm glad. I don't know if he's ever shared with Linda or not, but the purpose of this conversation was that this gentleman, with whom all of you would agree was a man of great vision and foresight, the principal point he wanted to make to me was, since I'd been involved and allied with the governor during his election and interested in the elective side of politics, was that he saw the possibilities, notwithstanding South Dakota, that Governor George Mickelson could rise and possibly be the president of this country someday. And he wanted to be sure that there was people who around him that encouraged him to keep looking ahead and keep a vision for the future. And who knows what might have occurred along those lines.
One of the attributes that I believe he also had with vision was courage. And as Dwight has pointed out, he was a great leader, and you have to have courage to take the forceful, important decision when it needs to be done. And with them, economic development, for example, he took the unpopular step of putting on a temporary sales tax, which was the right move, but it took courage to do that. So I think that's an important attribute he also had.
One of the things that that struck me, and we do have some viewer questions I want to get to as well. We mentioned water development and economic development, and I want to mention reconciliation. I thought that was probably one of the most selfless things I'd seen from a politician. I didn't see where it benefited him politically in any way, and I'd heard both Indians and whites say, well, it was just a front to get him reelected. I didn't think so. I thought it was maybe enlightenment on his part, that he had come to certain conclusions in his life about race relations in our state, and he was going to do something to better. Maybe it wasn't absolutely what everyone wanted, but by golly, it was going to be a sincere effort to take care of one of the most difficult, perplexing problems that this state has faced since statehood and before. And I guess in the things that I remember and cover, and since in his passion, that was something that meant an awful lot to him, and he did it because it was like the right thing to do.
Certainly that's not.
That's absolutely correct, Todd. It was not done. His motivation wasn't for political gain. It was something that reflected the moral character and the values of the man, and he truly believed in it, and he worked hard to try to make that work, and he made strides, particularly in that first year or two. He made strides in that program, and it was a real thing with him in which he was tremendously interested.
Certainly, it couldn't have been for political reasons. It wasn't frankly, a real popular thing to do. No. There were people in really both parties, but certainly I know of those in his own party in the legislature that thought there were other things to do that year, and it was something he just felt strongly about.
We had a couple of viewers call in, and maybe this is crass, I don't know, but I think it's a legitimate question. People don't know who Walter Dale Miller is. Lieutenant governor is not a position, it's like being vice president. It's kind of a background position. Walter Dale seems to have had quite a bit of limelight for lieutenant governor. What is Walter Dale like? What's his politics? What kind of man is he? How will he fill these shoes?
Well, certainly, this lieutenant governor has been, I suppose all lieutenant governors have been active in one form or another with their administrations, but this lieutenant governor has been more active of being involved in the day-to-day things of state government than perhaps any other, just by virtue of making it a full-time position in one way or another. He goes to the Capitol every day and has, and there have been other attempts to do that, but this was Lieutenant Governor Walter Dale Miller was the first one who was a full-time lieutenant governor, very much involved, head of the operations part of the governor's office at different times, and so he's not a lieutenant governor that's coming without having knowledge of how state government works and knowing who the people are and where the buttons are to push and so on in state government.
Prior to his being lieutenant governor, he was in the House of Representatives a long time. Very well-respected, capable leader there. And for I know him personally, a very intelligent, dedicated, good person. I think he will handle the job well.
He had served in the legislature, I believe, something like 20 years prior to that, so he certainly is well-experienced in state government. But I'll tell you what George Mickelson thought of him. He thought of him as one of his very closest friends, and he considered him to be his mentor. Walter Dale had taken George under his wing somewhat when George went to the legislature as a freshman and helped him learn the ropes and learn the processes and procedures. And I can also tell you that there was no issue of any consequence whatsoever that ever came up during the time that I spent out in Pierre as the state chairman and in the second campaign when I saw things firsthand day to day. There was no issue, no time at all, but what the governor didn't confer with Walter Dale and valued his views and opinions and wisdom with regard to whatever the issues were. So he is an experienced man who can well step into this task that he's facing now.
Let me update our viewers and listeners a little bit. Some information. Spokeswoman says there's no immediate plans to swear in Walter Dale Miller as governor of South Dakota yet. This is from the Associated Press. According to South Dakota's Constitution, Lieutenant Governor will serve out the governor's term. Once he takes office, Miller can nominate Lieutenant Governor. We've talked about that. There have been condolences coming in from around the nation. Mickelson, kind of this bipartisanship we've been talking about, Mickelson had promoted Governor Sinner from North Dakota as Ag Secretary when Governor Clinton was elected president, and Governor George Sinner sends his condolences. Also, current Governor Ed Schaefer from North Dakota has sent his condolences. Senator Pressler has given his condolences. Senator Daschle has sent his condolences. And Senator Daschle said, "I had a profound admiration for his dedication, his leadership, his sense of purpose." And some people have called and want to know who some of the other folks were on the aircraft. And again, Governor Mickelson, Roger Hangey, director of the Sioux Falls Development Foundation, Roland Dolly, the state economic development director, Ron Reed, the state energy policy commissioner, Dave Berklin, a Sioux Falls banker, Angus Anson of Northern States Power in Sioux Falls, and pilots Ron Becker and Dave Hansen from Pier. And I probably knew Roland about the best, closest to me in age and so forth. And I know a real go-getter of a person, always wore these beautifully starched shirts that I just envied so. And Ron Reed, another Brookings resident here. This is a great, terrible loss for our community on the heels of track athlete Wade Knutson from SDSU dying at a track meet in the pole vault. A lot of bad news here in our state. I'll try to get through some more of these questions. We are taking your questions at 800-568-6922. We also hope to have some tape clips from some of Governor Mickelson's prior appearances on South Dakota Public Television and State of the State address and so forth, and we'll be getting those a little bit later. We're also hoping to have a tape feed from KDUB TV in Dubuque, which is the ABC affiliate. What was the final destination of the plane from Brookings? I believe they were going to Cincinnati to John Morrell's.
They had been to Cincinnati already. Okay. They left Brookings early this morning to go. By 4 o'clock in the afternoon, they would have been on their way back. It's not clear to me whether the plane had landed at Dubuque before and taken off, or if it was just flying by and had the difficulties. But they were on their way back to South Dakota.
Some of the other folks, I'm sure some of Roger Hangey's been very active in economic development in the Sioux Falls area and making Sioux Falls the best city to live in, according to Money Magazine. Ron Reed was a development chamber official here in Brookings.
Angus Hansen had served in as a staff member in the Congress when Clint Roberts was in the Congress. In recent years, for a number of years recently, had been with the firm in Sioux Falls, Northwest.
Okay, we have a soundbite from Governor George Mickelson recently on his health care plan. We'll go ahead and roll that.
The basic premise of the health care reform that I have introduced this year is in two areas. Number one is cost control. We have to begin to control the costs. And number two, we have to begin to address the access issue. That is covering more of our people than we do now.
Okay, we'll be having some more sound bites from the governor through the years here on public broadcasting, South Dakota Public Television and Radio. This is kind of a protocol question. Anybody knows, do we fly the flag at half staff? Is that something we'll be doing tomorrow?
It would be appropriate to do so.
I would certainly think so.
Okay. This is kind of television on and radio as we go along, folks, so please bear with us. Harold Salway, the former president of the Oglala Sioux Tribe, called in earlier from Rapid City and expressed his condolences as well. Thank you, Harold. And what's the chain of command in a situation like this? I guess, how does the governor's office operate, and who's doing what? I guess none of us are privy to that, but how would the governor's office be operating in this crisis to try to make sure that the media is informed, that the families are taken care of, that government continues on? Anybody have any insight on that?
Well, I would assume that Walter Dale Miller, you know, would be the number one in charge at this point, and things would revolve around him. But I'm sure he's working with all the senior staff people, the other cabinet officers, and everyone involved is working together on it.
I had heard earlier that there had been a cabinet meeting that was still fairly early in the evening, Janelle told me that they hadn't had time for any of that, but. Certainly, you know, Frank Brost, Chief of Staff, is very much involved. There's just a lot of things to be thinking about. You know, the state government is going to run probably the operation of state government day to day is probably the least of the things right now. There are good people in the places to make the decisions and do the things that are going to happen. I'm not sure what the numbers are, where it goes from governor, lieutenant governor. Does it go to speaker of the house?
That
kind of
should have a tragic event where the governor and lieutenant governor should both be killed, I'm not sure what the succession is there. But otherwise, lieutenant governor becomes governor and has the power to appoint lieutenant governor, so you have a perpetual filling of that position. Not unlike the presidency and vice presidency of the United States.
Statement from Lieutenant Governor Miller says his thoughts and prayers are with members of all those who lost loved ones. And He says he has no words to describe the loss of Governor George Mickelson. I think the Lieutenant Governor speaks for most of us. We've all been kind of just reacting and rather numb. I wonder if Roger McHelps, you still on the phone with us?
Still here.
Roger, some of us have talked about our dealings with the governor. Is there one George Mickelson story that stands out in your mind through all the years you've known him?
Well, there's a number of things that stand out in my mind. Is, you know, his sense of humor. He just loved a good joke. But, you know, his real determination, I think, that he, number one, wanted to be a good governor. You know, I think he was really committed to trying to do his very best. And secondly, he wanted to move South Dakota forward. And you can't be governor without some setbacks, without some successes. So, but I think he had more successes than he had setbacks. And regardless of how we might have differed at times, I never once questioned his motives that he wanted to do what he thought was best for South Dakota. I never saw him, second deal or anything like that. You know, he was upfront with everything. He wanted to do what was best. And Walter Dale Miller now has got a tremendous challenge, to pick up the pieces and to try to move those programs forward. I might offer our help, Walter, you're going to need all the help you can get, and I hope you'll use us because we'll be there and do everything we can to keep moving forward for the next year.
We have a soundbite queued up from Governor Mickelson on Deadwood gambling from the 1993 session.
Gaming is one part of it, but it's only a very small part of it. In fact, I think that in the not too distant future, people are going to go to Deadwood not for gaming. That might be something that they might want to do, but they're going to go there for good quality restaurants, a five-star hotel, conventions, maybe winter sports, certainly art and the historic preservation that is going on out there. So,
okay, we're back. We're having trouble getting the feed from KDUB from footage of the crash site and so forth, so we're not sure we're going to be able to get that for you, but we're trying. We still have some time remaining for your questions. Again, we're doing our best. There's a lot of things we don't know at this point, and I'm sure by tomorrow morning we'll know a lot more. But we'll give it our best shot. 1-800-568-6922. Normally Garden Line would be on at this time, but we have preempted Garden Line because of the tragic plane crash with Governor Mickelson and a party of seven others who were on an economic development trip to Cincinnati to work on some difficulties that John Morrell has been having in Sioux Falls. A viewer from Sioux Falls called in. Want to know about the governor's policy carrying on in reference to Native Americans, and what can we do, or what can we do to keep the process going, and is there a legacy to carry it on? We talked about this a little bit.
Well, I think there is a need to carry it on. He really was well-intended, and he did start a good effort toward reconciliation, and I hope very strongly that many of us do carry this on. We do have a very definite problem with relationships between Native Americans and those of us that came later, and we definitely do need an effort toward reconciliation, so I hope very sincerely that we do make an effort to carry it on and improve if we can.
Also, kind of in the same vein, he had a change of heart about not just Native American Day, but Martin Luther King Day. Had been kind of opposed to it, and then the 90 session now, 91 session.
I believe it was the 90
session.
When there was a bill in the House and it didn't make it through committee. Day and a half later, less than 36 hours from when the time it was defeated in the House State Affairs Committee, it was back on the agenda, and the Republican leadership was not only supporting it, but they were going to come with the Native American Day idea, which was not in the original Martin Luther King Day bill. It made it a better proposal. I think Republicans and Democrats both thought it was better after that.
I guess one of the analogies, Dwight, you had mentioned that maybe he should have thought, should have been thinking about higher political office, maybe president. I guess I always kind of thought about him and Clinton kind of in the kind of maybe mirror reflections of the moderate wings of their party. And both governors for a long time in small rural states. They knew each other, I understand.
Yes, they did.
Served on a number of committees at National Governors Association. I always thought that was kind of interesting, kind of the politics of inclusion, not exclusion. Mm-hmm. I guess I was always, I don't know, maybe that's a stretch, but I always thought that was kind of interesting.
I remember visiting with Governor Mickelson prior to the primaries of the last presidential campaign, and he said, you know, he knew Governor Clinton, governor at that time, and said he was a fine person, wouldn't be surprised if he went quite a ways, and turned out to be accurate.
I think, you know, the reconciliation issue is an example of the governor looking way beyond the obvious. You know, reconciliation means a lot of things to a lot of people, but he was looking at it, I think, can't speak for him, of course, but as a way to improve things for everyone in the state. In the gambling issue, the Deadwood issue that we just heard the little clip there, regardless of what you think of that issue and that situation in Deadwood or in the state, he was looking at it beyond the obvious Deadwood gaming in Deadwood. He was thinking about it for the benefits of the whole state. And I think that's what turned him around in that, because if you recall, he opposed increasing the bet limit over the years. Vetoed the $25 bet limit when it came to his desk, but it was much more. This proposal from the Costners was much more than just increasing the bet limit, and he saw much more in it for the state than just Deadwood.
Chuck Lean from Rapid City called in and expressed his condolences and says he knew the governor well, and thank you, Chuck, for expressing those. And I know you speak for a lot of people on this. One of the other issues with Governor Mickelson that I was always kind of surprised about that he had such passion for was water development. And I mean, I think we all kind of intellectually know that water development is important, but it doesn't usually generate that much passion in people. When we do a show on it here, there's not that many calls or anything. But I remember Governor Mickelson telling me one time, he goes, I was standing on a hill with my dad, George T. Mickelson, on a windswept pier north of Pier, and it was General Pick and Sloan, the Pick Sloan guys, and by God, they made these promises to South Dakota. And he goes, I think he felt like it was somehow in his destiny because of his dad that he was going to fulfill that promise that was made to us and that potential for the state. And I don't, Dwight, maybe you have some insight into...
No, that too was a cornerstone from before he went into office the first time of his many concerns about the needs in South Dakota was water development. It was the fact that he seriously viewed that we had been made promises, commitments had been made when this land was removed and put underwater, and that they had never been fulfilled, and that unless we united here together, and that's what he really wanted to do, was get unity in the state so that we then could bring pressure on the federal government to carry out and perform some of the things that had been committed to be done with water development here.
Okay, I understand we do have the video from KDUB, the ABC affiliate in Dubuque, Iowa. I don't know exactly what we're going to be seeing, so if you want to go ahead and roll that, we'll take a look and see the report. Okay, there it is. Okay, this is apparently the crash site near Dubuque. According to the Associated Press reports and other reports, the plane crashed into a barn and a silo. I had talked with a friend of mine, a former employee of South Dakota Public Television, Kelly Sullivan, and she had commented that it was a horrible fire. Firemen on the scene. There's going to be an interview here in just a little bit, too, as well. The governor flies in a MU-2 Mitsubishi. Okay, we're kind of deaf to this here in Vermilion. In Brookings. It's being rolled from Vermilion, so you, our viewers and listeners, are getting more of this than those of us here on the set. My friend Kelly Sullivan, again, our former employee of South Dakota Public Television, said that she had called the newsroom at KDUB for us a number of times this evening to try to find out details and to fix us up with who to talk to, and said it was absolute chaos there, a small local station trying to cover what is becoming a national story as well. And I think we have some more footage from KDUB. Okay, we don't have any more footage. Again, the people on the aircraft on the screen, Governor George Mickelson, Roger Hangey, Roland Dolly, Ron Reed, Dave Berkland, Angus Anson, Ron Becker, Dave Hansen. Ron and Dave were the pilots of the Governor's MU-2 Mitsubishi turboprop, a beautiful aircraft I've had the privilege to ride in a number of times. It was a controversial airplane when Governor Janklow purchased it, I believe, but a beautiful aircraft. And our condolences to the families of all the people there involved in this this tragedy. Update. Let's see here. Again, this is has been confirmed by the sheriff in Jackson County, Iowa, that Governor Mickelson has died in a plane crash in eastern Iowa. Letting you know again, the governor was on an economic development flight with seven others, going to Cincinnati to the headquarters of John Morrell. Apparently encountered some sort of aircraft problem, and perhaps problems with the weather too. I'm a little bit unclear on that. And the plane was forced down near southwest of Dubuque, Iowa. And we saw from the pictures there just a little bit ago, crashed into a silo and a barn. We have an address. If you wish to express your condolences to Governor Mickelson's family, you can send your condolences to this address: Governor's Office, Capitol Building, 500 East Capitol Avenue, Pierce, South Dakota, 57501507 0. And let's leave that up there for a little bit so people can see that, and you can write that down.
Todd, as I understand it, there was engine trouble, and they had reported engine trouble and had gotten the permission to then land, emergency landing in Dubuque. And there was some question, and perhaps still is under investigation, about whether the weather had anything to do with it. There was heavy rain at the time.
Okay, we're just about out of time. This has been a special report on South Dakota Public Television and Radio with the tragic accident of Governor Mickelson's crash of his aircraft and seven others aboard dying. Stay tuned to South Dakota Public Radio for the latest details. Thank you very much for tuning in this evening. Good night.
This has been a special report of South Dakota Public Television.